This podcast is part of the Pod Syndicate family. For more criminally compelling shows, articles, and conversations, head to wearepodsyndicate.com.
Two men journey to the bars and restaurants of Scandinavia to find amazing beers, always with the same question.
Hey, what's on tap?
It's time to find out.
What's on tap podcast? Once again, excited to come to you to talk about all things beer and beer related.
Beer? Is this a beer podcast?
It is a beer podcast.
Wow.
And I am your ever effervescent and lovely host, Stefan.
And I'm your lovelier host, Martin.
And just as effervescent. So we're excited today. You're sparkly and bubbly, as always.
Oh, that's nice.
Yes. You are the bubbles in my beer. You lift the podcast up with your excitement and joy.
Today we thought we would surprise you by drinking beer.
It's a real change for the show. We thought we'd go in a different direction than what we've been doing for the past 3 years. And focus more on beer.
Yes.
So the knitting is all behind us now. We will not be talking about knitting anymore. Only beer from now.
Those episodes are now collector's edition.
Yep, we have burned them off to singles. So if you want to get your cassette single, you just need to write us, send us $10.95 plus shipping and handling, and we will mail you individually each episode on your very own cassette single.
Wow.
I know. It's a very exciting offer. I think most people are going to be very excited with this offer.
Yes.
But
I'm quite excited about the beers we have.
I am too. We have two very interesting beers today, I think. First up is what you brought, and tell us about your beer.
So I brought a beer from Other Half, from the States.
Do we know which state?
I'm going to say New York State, but that might be completely wrong.
It's very possible. I'm not sure myself.
It doesn't say. This is Other Half Cobbler Jams, which is a...
Now, wait, before you... Is this a series of beers? Do they have, like... Other cobbler jams, like is there like a blueberry cinnamon maple cobbler's jam, or is it just like this particular one is called cobbler's jam?
I do not know.
Because it feels like it should be a series.
Yes.
Because it's called cobbler's jam, so it feels like there should be more than one version of this beer based on the title alone.
I do agree with you. This is, let me see. I'm actually searching right now. This is live research. No.
Okay.
There's only one Other Half Cobbler Jams, and it is this one.
Well, fuck you, Other Half, and your lack of imagination.
No.
Yes.
Because this is a peach and raspberry India Pale Ale with peach, raspberry, cinnamon, honey, vanilla, and milk sugar.
That's what I'm saying. There should be a series. Should be at least three in this series. There should be a raspberry version and a blueberry version, maybe a boysenberry or marmalade version. I mean, there's a lot of potential for this to be a series of beers.
Yeah, it clocks in at 8.2%.
Nice. It's good to know that we're not doing light beers. We're on a roll.
It looks like actual jam.
It really does. It is. If you were to say murky, murky would be an understatement.
Hazy would be a lie.
I think there are stouts that are less thick than this.
Yes.
This is by far the most, I think, the large definition of a milkshake IPA I think I've ever seen.
Yes.
And it smells like peaches and raspberries.
Sweet jams.
It smells like raspberry. So much raspberry. I don't get much cinnamon on the nose and don't really feel the milk sugars. I do feel like I'm going to have a fruity flavor bomb just explode, like a bukkake flavor bomb all over my mouth.
Wow.
That's how much fruit I'm expecting out of this. So what do you think?
I think we should taste it.
Let's get into this bad boy.
Cheers.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. That is a bit weird. It's a little unbalanced.
It's jams for sure.
Man, there's a lot going on in this. Okay, so first of all, what I'm not getting is cinnamon.
No, me neither.
Okay, which is really weird because cinnamon should be really prevalent in this beer. I mean, it should be like an edge of cinnamon that just floats through everything and kind of unites it all.
Yeah, in the aftertaste, I do get some kind of spiciness. But in the main flavor, I do get peaches, I do get raspberry, and I do get vanilla.
I do get peaches and raspberry and vanilla and milk sugar. It honestly, it tastes like Starburst fruit candy.
Starburst? I'm not used to that in Sweden.
What would be the equivalent of a Starburst? A fruit taffy of some sort.
Okay.
Not like, you know what it is? It's those little individually wrapped, you know, the lemon candies that are individually wrapped that look like a little lemon on the outside?
No.
Oh, they're so popular here. You see them in like every candy aisle.
Are they filled with some kind of lemon powder?
No, there's no lemon powder. There's just like a lemon chew.
No,
a chew. So like a taffy, no. Chewy thing. Or Bamba?
Bamba?
Is that a thing? Is that what it's called?
Bamba is the Gothenburg name for the school lunch lady.
So I don't eat a lot of Swedish candies. But there is a Swedish candy that comes in a pack. And they're little squares. And they have fruit flavors. And they're really chewy.
I have no idea what
you do. About. Once I find out what it's called, you'll be like,
okay. I think I know what you're talking about. No, this doesn't taste like it.
Well, what is it called?
I don't know.
Ugh, you're the worst. I wish I wasn't using my phone to record because I could look it up.
Haha, he has no internet power.
Exactly. It kills me sometimes. Oh, wait, you know what? I have another phone over here.
Whoa, look at Mr. Rich Guy with two phones. Well, why am I bringing beer?
I know.
To get back to it, this is actually a super fun beer. But it is weird. These flavors are all over the place.
I completely agree. They are a bit
the fact that they say
unbalanced.
That the fact that they say that this is an IPA in its core, I don't get it.
Yeah, I'm not feeling very IPA-ish here either. It feels... No. I don't even know what to call it.
Fruit beer.
It is a fruit beer. I will give you that.
It's not that sour. It's more sweet.
Yeah, sour. I mean, the sour is almost like a high note.
Yeah.
It's not a sweet beer, a sour beer in any way whatsoever. Although it is a bit sour.
Mm-hmm.
But I like that. Oof. I like that the little biting tartness of it because it feels like you're actually getting the sweetness and the fruitiness coming through that you would get from the raspberries.
Yeah.
And I had to think that the raspberries is providing a lot of that... That sweetness or that sourness.
So I'm reading now on the internet that it's supposed to taste like a pie. That's the cobbler's pie.
Yeah. No, I get what they were going for with the pie reference because all of those things put together would make a kind of like pie flavor with like vanilla ice cream on top or vanilla sauce like you get in Sweden. But
I am more getting
the pie flavor. Really hit that.
Now that I know what to look for, I'm more getting pie. I'm getting the pie crust now.
I guess so.
The more you drink of it, the better it works.
I think maybe it's too cold. Maybe that's one of the issues.
Maybe.
If it warms up a little bit more, you would get more of the... more of the pie essence.
Then
I think that's where the malts with the sugar, I'm sorry, malts with the sugar and the cinnamon is supposed to come in and make a pie or a cobbler kind of essence. But
then let's put it aside and talk about other things.
All right.
Like, for example, that we are a part of a pod syndicate.
We are. Called Pod Syndicate.
Yeah.
And we will take a break and then come back and try the other beer and then wrap it up with a revisit to the first beer and see how we feel about that.
That's a really good idea.
All right.
See you soon.
Mm-hmm. Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, and welcome to Film Bastards, a podcast where three friends, two of them married and two of them podcasting life partners, chat everything from new releases, trailers, news, and an eclectic mix of other film goodies over many, many, many tangents. You can find them by searching your podcast provider or check them out on Twitter and Instagram by searching Film Bastards. You never know, you might like it. And if you don't, well, we don't really give a f***.
Have you ever wondered what so-called family films will scar your kids forever?
Putting 4 and 5 year olds in front of this movie, it's like, if they didn't know what death was before this, they're going to know it after it.
They're going to know it after it, and they're going to be freaking terrified.
And they're going to be questioning it.
Yeah.
Or do you have the slight suspicion that your loved one has a cold, dead heart?
Yeah, The Dark Knight has got like all the orphans and like, oh no, we're going to die. They did not build up those orphans at all. In my head, I was like, kill them.
Then look no further. The His Film Her Movie podcast is the show for you. It's the movie podcast that celebrates the contrasting cinematic tastes of its hosts. So join Jordan and Lauren every week on their unique journey through the land of the silver screen. So if you're looking for a few laughs, some fun film-related chat, then get involved. You can find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts.
Okay, welcome back.
Woo!
Are you ready to get into the next beer?
Yes. Okay. I've been waiting for so long.
We've all been waiting for so long. We're very excited about this. It is a Dessert Beer Geek from Mikkeller. Comes in at 11% ABV. I don't know if this is a every year release, but the last time I had it was in 2016.
Uh-huh.
And I quite enjoyed it, but we'll see how it goes.
It's for sure a Mikkeller classic that's been remade. It has like 2 or 3 or 4 different labels.
Oh, for sure.
It goes through a lot of reinvention.
Well, Mikkeller has relabeled their Beer Geek cans in the past couple of years. So it has become a bit more less intense in their packaging colors.
Yeah.
And they really pared it down to just a simple image of a, what's his name, Henry?
Yeah.
The Henry character in a cup of coffee, kind
yeah.
of.
Yeah. What's interesting is that earlier versions used to have a civet cat, the weasel-like cat-like creature that eats coffee beans
mm-hmm.
and like
poops them out.
For the Kopi Luwak coffee.
Yeah.
I think Mikkeller stopped using Kopi Luwak after report of civet cat creatures being mistreated in Vietnam.
Were they really using civet cats in their coffee, in their beers? Because that's like
they,
one of the most expensive beer coffees in the world that they're just dumping into beer. It seems like a misuse of that particular
So yes, style. Mikkeller used to use Kopi Luwak.
Yeah.
Alesmith used to use Kopi Luwak in their like Speedway variants.
Yeah.
And they all basically stopped when reports came out that the civet cats were being bred in captivity and held in small cages and basically force-fed coffee beans.
Well, of course they were. That's how that process works. You mean they're not just like going out and randomly hoping that these civet cats just poop, you know, beans. They have to control that process. It's become a manufacturing process.
Yes.
It's the same reason why a lot of places have banned foie gras.
Yes.
Because when you basically just have a goose with his head out of the cage and they shove a funnel down his throat and then just force feed it shit tons of grain, yeah, is inhumane. But that's the process if you want to like be able to reproduce the same thing over and over again, you know?
Yes.
It's fucking inhumane. We get it. All right. So this is the oatmeal stout brewed with cocoa and vanilla. No coffee was harmed in the making of this beer.
It says so?
Well, it doesn't say there's coffee in it.
Uh-huh.
It says cocoa and vanilla.
Maybe I'm remembering incorrectly.
No, there used to be a civet that they used to put on a lot of their Beer Geeks.
Yeah.
But I think it was their breakfast version.
Uh-huh.
May have been it. Oh, yeah, this is so much a classic Mikkeller stout. And this is brewed with Lervig, although it doesn't say so on the can. But if you look it up on Untappd, you will see that there is a Lervig collaboration listed on there. It is bottled at, it's brewed by Lervig, so yeah. It's written on the can, but it's very, very fine print.
And I need to retract my earlier statement. It's not dessert, it's Beer Geek brunch.
Yeah.
That used to have the Cobbler coffee.
Yeah, that makes more sense. But this smells just so much cocoa and vanilla.
It smells cocoa dusty, like cocoa dust.
Yeah, like they used the cocoa nibs in it.
Probably.
Yeah.
You want to try it?
Oh, yeah.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Viscous.
Yeah, it is thick in the mouthfeel. It's very chocolate, very vanilla.
Yeah.
Very smooth. 11%. It's alarming because you could easily down a can of this, I think,
pretty quick. It's very smooth. There is, in the aftertaste, it is so dusty. Like I'm almost coughing from the amount of dust it's leaving in my throat.
See, I don't feel it's that dusty. I feel
powdery,
that it's,
powdery.
No, I mean powdery, I know what you're going for there. But I don't know that it's that powdery. I think it's more, for me it's just intensely sweet. And it's a little bit aggressively bitter.
Yeah.
Like the bitterness is much higher than I would expect from this kind of beer. Considering how freakishly sweet it is. It's almost like my tongue is kind of like doesn't know what to think because it's like it's so sweet, but yet it's like oh it's so bitter at the same time.
Yep,
it's really weird. And the last time I had this beer, I gave it like a 4.5, 4.25. Yeah. I really, really liked it, and I don't know if it was just because you couldn't get a lot of beers like this, so it was like oh wow, this is blowing my mind,
maybe
kind of thing, or if they've changed something, you know. Over time, standards change, and even though you're brewing the same beer, the quality of ingredients and the access to what you have and what you do is something different. But it's still interesting and good. But
last time I had this was 2014. Whoa. That was a bottle with the old design.
Yeah.
It's not a bad beer. But I'm not liking it as much now as I did in the past.
Yeah, I feel the exact same way. It's not a bad beer, but for me, it's just too sweet. It's almost cloyingly sweet.
Yeah.
And the bitterness is...
off-putting.
Abrasive. Yeah, it is off-putting. So I'm going to have to lower my rating on this one.
I'm
going to
give this a very weak 4.
I was thinking 3.75.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I get it.
Because it hurts.
What I find myself doing with beers like this when I want to like them, because I do like the original style, like, and I do like the ingredients in it. I try to, my brain, even though I'm not doing it consciously, tries to hold on to the good parts of a beer. Mm-hmm. Like, of course. Vanilla, cocoa. And then it's like, oh, there's also abrasiveness. Okay, fine, I'm not going to give it a 5. It's like my brain is negotiating with itself.
Yeah. But I mean, that's really human nature, is we want to find the good in things. And our mind is really good about making us forget the bad things that happened and helping us remember the good things that are happening. So even if you have a horrible experience, your mind will eventually turn it over enough to where it's either... not as bad, or you can almost joke about it because your mind will protect you against the horribleness of a lot of situations.
So that's why that's why you miss all your ex-girlfriends?
Well, like, I'm just saying, like, this isn't 100% true, and this isn't against like really horrible like things that happen to people, but in your general day-to-day course of life, you may have had a job you hated, you may have had an experience that was not the best. But when you go back and you reflect on it, you laugh about like the situation that you were put in. Of course, there's always things like
Yeah, but
horrible human atrocities that will not, your mind will not let you overcome. But there are enough day-to-day things that are bad experiences that your mind will reflect upon and give it a more positive spin.
Yeah, like old employments that were really crappy, but you remember, oh, I had such good colleagues.
Exactly. Like I had one job that basically the owners of the franchise came in, fired all of the top managers except for me and one other guy. Because they were all ripping the place off left and right. And when I think back on that story, I have a lot of really great stories I could tell you about things that happened at that place.
Probably.
No, they are. They're a lot of fun. But when I was living there and experiencing those things, it was a fucking nightmare. But, you know, when you think back 20, 25 years later, you're kind of like, oh, well, you know, it was like, you're not going to believe, like, what happened at this place. It was so crazy. What were we talking about? Oh, this beer. This dessert beer.
My brain wanted to give it a 4.
Right. And so you ended 4, I ended 3.75. Let's circle back around to the...
Cobbler Jams.
Cobbler Jams.
Let's see if it tastes more like pie now.
No. It does not taste more like pie. But I think... the flavors are much more balanced this time around. I think it was a little too cold.
Yeah.
It needed to breathe a little bit. It needed to open up. And I feel like this is...
it smells more like cinnamon now.
Yeah, I'm getting more of the cinnamon. I'm getting more of that kind of cobbler, pie crusty kind of thing. Now, do you know what the difference is between a pie and a cobbler and a... a buckle?
No.
Okay. So a pie is a crust on the bottom and everything's cooked inside the crust, right?
Okay. So there's a crust on the side as well.
This crust. So you take a traditional tart pan,
yep,
or pie pan, and you put the crust on the bottom and then you pre-bake it and you take it out and then you put the jam and the filling on the inside and then you bake the whole thing together, right?
So is there a wall of crust around it?
There's a wall of crust around it.
Good.
Right?
I get it.
Okay. So then a tart kind of concept for European standards. Because you don't have pies here. You don't understand what pies are. but then you get a cobbler or a buckle. Buckles are northern, cobbler are southern. And what you do is you take the pan and you fill it with the fruit filling. And then you put the... so a crumble is kind of the closest comparison in Sweden, which is an oatmeal, sugar, butter...
Mixture
that you crumble over the top of fruit in a pan. That's usually mixed with sugar and lemon and whatever. A cobbler is kind of the same way, because you take dough and you put dough on top of it. And then the pie dough you take and you put it on top in little clusters.
Mm-hmm.
Then when you bake it, you got the crispy pie dough on top, and you got the, and it becomes really soft underneath because it's absorbed the fruit filling.
Okay.
So you got this crusty pie with a little bit of the soft doughy under texture, and then the cobbler or the filling underneath that, and it's quite delicious.
Okay.
I highly recommend investing in cobbler technology. You will not be disappointed.
Cobbler technologies.
Yes. So what do you give Cobbler Jams?
Now that it's gotten time to aerate, I'm gonna give it a 4.25. It's hitting a lot of my weird appreciator notes.
I respect that. I respect the hell out of that decision.
You're gonna give it a 3.5.
I can easily see how you get there. No, I'm actually gonna give it a 3.75.
Okay.
Because I do feel in the end it's a little unbalanced.
like we are.
It is a little all over the place. I like it. I think it's pretty good. We haven't even talked about the honey on this. I think the honey is just kind of like lost in the mix. I don't think I was really giving anything here. But I do feel like it's a good experience. I'm glad that they tried this. But
they should have made 4 different variants.
They should have made 4 different variants.
Blueberry cobbler and a peach cobbler.
Well, no, we got peach. We need blueberry. We need like boysenberry. We need like apricot.
Yeah.
There could be a blackberry version.
Mm.
You know, there's a lot.
Would you ever make an apple cobbler?
Well, technically, you wouldn't make an apple or cobbler. You make an apple crisp.
Okay.
But basically, yeah, it's a cobbler.
We're getting into crisps.
Well, it's a different functionality because of the way the apples are when you cook them. It's like with pears. Pears and apples kind of fall into the same thing. Okay. You would never do a cobbler like that because of the way the apples cook down and into the liquids.
Okay.
The way they break down inside the... Yeah. Whereas your berries and your stone fruits break down in a separate, in a different way. So that's why you would use those in one version, whereas the apples you want to more concentrate the amount of apple that you use, whereas the peach or the cobbler is a looser collection of the the fruits.
I get it. So this is What's in a Pie podcast.com.
Exactly. So if you want to know more about molecular gastronomy and how pies and how different fruits break down inside a cobbler when they bake, tune in for our next episode of What's on Pie podcast.com. Until next time, you can still find us on whatsontappodcast.com, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, Spotify. Am I forgetting something?
Wherever you can find good quality podcasts, I believe we are available.
Exactly, which means you can also find us on We Are Pod Syndicate.
Yes.
So until next time.
Keep drinking, you dum-dums.
This podcast is part of the Pod Syndicate family. For more criminally compelling shows, articles, and conversations, head to wearepodsyndicate.com.